Pastors, you know, it ain't the first time I preach with no shoes on. You know, I remember I was in service one time, and this was when the Lord was getting ready to, for the first time, I was actually going to begin to minister. I was at Resurrection Life, and my brother and my family were all there with me. I had set up the tabernacle of Moses. And, you know, this was years after he's downloading, you know, and revealing all kind of things to me and showing me. I'm now going to be able to get the opportunity to be able to start sharing stuff with people, you know. And good to see you guys. And it was actually the second time I got to minister from a pulpit, from an altar, you know, up at the on stage. And it was about, I ministered on, about come up higher. It was about coming up higher, because God wants us to come up higher so we can get a better view on things, to see the way He sees things, you know. And that coming up higher, you know, is we do that. The more we put the Word in us, you know, the closer we get to where God is, you know. And so anyway, I had ministered the first message there. It was, you know, it was the 8:30 service. And I'm about to be in praise and worship for the next service, and you know, I'm sitting down, and I'm sitting down, and man, the Lord told me to. He starts revealing things to me while I'm sitting there, and He starts revealing some things about. He told me that, you know, here it is. I'm doing a teaching on the tabernacle of Moses, the brazen altar and the laver, the lampstand, the showbread table, the altar of incense, the ark of the covenant. It's all set up. And I was teaching on, and also I had set up, I had the full armor of God next to it. So, meaning, you know, I was connecting the dots how the children of Israel had wandered through the wilderness in the shape of a cross. Remember that? And when God set the armies up, the 600,000 men, six is the number of man, right? It says that He put 108,000 in the front of the camp, 180,000 in the back, and 150,000 on either side, right? So the head is shorter than the tail, right? And then about equal on either side. But the right side, the camp had 157,000, right? And on the left side, there was 151,000. It was 600,000 difference. So if you look at the tabernacle of Moses, we know that the tabernacle represented a man. It was in the shape of a cross. It moved through the wilderness for 40 years. You with me there, right? It was in the shape of a cross. And I remember a guy had told me one time that he said, you know, Jesus died on a stake, not on a cross. A cross is actually sacrilege.
Amen.
You know, that's what he said to me. And I said, what are you talking about, man? He said, and because the word actually translates stake, or, you know, he was hanged on a tree. It's actually, he was, you know, on a tree, it says. And he said, yeah, the cross is not mentioned nowhere else in Scripture other than what they had done with right there when they supposedly hung him on a cross and not a stake. I said, hold on a second. I said, I'm going to show you a cross in the beginning. So I took him back to the beginning. I showed him the tabernacle of Moses and how God, when He set that tabernacle up, not only did He set the pieces up, the altar, the laver, the lampstand, the showbread table, the altar of incense, and the ark, not only did He set it up in a cross, but when He set the armies of Israel up around it, He put 108, 180, 156, 157, and 151, right? So from a bird's eye view looking down, a mile and a half long, the children of Israel wandered through the wilderness in the shape of the cross, and He was blown away. I said, so I don't want to hear anything about the cross, because it's, and I can show you other places. The four rivers that went out of Eden, they went north, south, east, and west, which is the four heads, or the four gospels going into all the world. That's why the angels gather the elect from the four winds, from the north, south, east, and west. The word of God spreading out. But anyway, so when I was doing this teaching that was I had not only, because God, we know that the tabernacle, the Bible says the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us, you and me, the Word became flesh, the tabernacle of the Lord, which they call the tabernacle of testimony, which they call the tabernacle of Moses, was actually a picture and a type that Jesus became flesh and tabernacled among you and me. And he was the one that was going to fulfill that, right? So when I knew God set the armies up around it, right, and 600,000 men, six is the number of man, so now you have a man on a cross, which is, you know, pretty amazing. So now if it's an army set up around it, well then, the Bible talks about in Ephesians 6 about the full armor of God, right? So if we look at the full armor of God, then it's got to apply to the man that's on the cross, right? So if we start at the Ark of the Covenant, and, you know, the Bible talks about the helmet of salvation, right? If I'm tabernacle set up this way and we're going to move toward the east gate, here it is, you are in the Holy of Holies, the helmet of salvation, right? And the altar of incense would be the breastplate of righteousness. That would be Jesus Christ, right? And then we have the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness. You got the lampstand, which is the sword of the Spirit, the Bible says, right? Right? And then you got the table of showbread over here, which is the shield of faith. What is our faith? That Jesus died and rose again. He's the bread. That's what was on a table, right? So now you get to the door right here. And Jesus said in John 10:9, I'm the door. No man can come into the Father. Where's the Father? He's in a holy place. Except through me. Right?
Amen.
Gird about your loins with a belt. Where does a belt go? At your waist. So the door of the tabernacle is literally the waist of it, where the man is hanging. If you look at Christ right there hanging on a cross, that's what moved through the wilderness. The waist is the belt of truth. And he says that he is the way and the truth and the life. The way is the gate. The truth is the door. The life is the Holy of Holies. Then there was two other things that was outside of that gate. There was a laver, right? And there was an altar. Now this is God's procession toward man, but man's procession towards God, where he would have to come through the brazen altar, a brass altar, and a laver, right? Which represents repentance and baptism. That's what those two brass items on the outside represent. It represents the judgment of flesh. Jesus was crucified outside the gate, right?
Amen.
Right? Mm-hmm. And that's what he went through, the brazen altar and the laver. That's how he bled blood and water. The altar is blood, the laver is water. That's how we come into Christ. But what really makes, you know, things amazing is that, you know, that's what separated the priest and the people from God that was in the holy place and the most holy place. In fact, God told the priest, he said, you know, when you make your sacrifice, when the sacrifice is made, don't bypass the water. Because if you do, when you come in, I'll kill you. That's literally what the law says. If you try to bypass the water without dying, you know, the blood, then you enter in, you'll die. Nadab and Abihu died in the holy place. They offered unclean fire on the altar of incense, and God killed them right there inside the tabernacle. That's right. Nadab and Abihu, so Eleazar and Ithamar had to take over for their two brothers. The unclean fire they offered was fire outside the camp. They had took it in and brought it and put it on the altar of incense, which that gets into another. But they were brass items. Now we know if Christ is hanging on a cross, the altar and the laver, what does it represent? Repentance and baptism. How beautiful are the feet of those that preach the gospel. The shoes, right, represent what? The gospel of peace. Ah, so now you have the tabernacle of Moses that's set up. It's set up in a cross with a number of 600,000, which six is the number of man. Christ is the one that was laid on that cross. So beyond the waist, right, which would be beyond, you know, the womb, if you wanted to call it, the where intimacy is in the holy place. But beyond the waist, now man doesn't have a womb, that'll get me into something else. But beyond the waist, the belt of truth is two pieces, the altar and the laver, and they were brass. And it's pretty amazing if you go to Revelations chapter 1 and you read when John, it says, and John was in on the Isle of Patmos for the testimony of Jesus Christ, right? For the word, right, that he was put in there. So he bore the testimony. He was put in there because he was preaching the gospel. So here it is. He is on an aisle in prison for the testimony of Jesus Christ. He hears a voice that speaks with him, and he's caught up into the holy place. How do we know that? Because when he goes up there, he sees the lampstand, right? And in the holy place is the lampstand and the showbread and all this stuff. And I'm leading and showing you something because it's going to go somewhere that's amazing. And it says when he describes Christ, you know, he describes him, his hair like wool and fire and all of this stuff. And he goes down, and when he gets to his feet, he says, and his feet was as brass that has been, you know, burned, right? His feet were brass. That's why the pieces that were outside the tabernacle of Moses was a brazing altar and a brazing laver, because brass represents judgment. So he's the one that was crucified outside the gate. He's the Ark of Testimony. That's what it was called. The Ark of the Lord, the Ark of Testimony, the testimony of the Lord, the tabernacle of Yeshua, the tabernacle of the Lord, that God was going to put a man in a flesh tent. That flesh tent moved in the wilderness for 40 years. That's why Jesus went in the wilderness for 40 days, right? It's just an exact repeat. But now, on that tabernacle, I had set up, you know, the helmet, the literal armor of God I had sitting on it. So they had a literal big Roman helmet and a breastplate of righteousness, because Paul was in jail when he wrote that in Ephesians. He's looking at the Romans and talks about you and I, you know, helmet of salvation, sword of spirit, shield of faith, breastplate of light, gird about your loins with the belt of truth, and shod your shoes with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So now we can see the armor can be placed on a man because the cross and the wilderness with the 600,000 that was around it. Six is the number of man. Adam was created on the sixth day, and it doesn't stop, because it's all about Jesus. So when I read, I look for Jesus in any kind of way, shape, or form. That's who I'm looking for, my love. He's the one I love. That's how we read the word. We're supposed to read it and look for him, right? So the first service, I ministered on it. So I'm sitting down there at the second. God gives me this revelation while I'm in church that I'm telling you. So I'm sitting down at Resurrection Life, and I'm on the front row, and we in praise and worship. And the Lord says, you know why the altar and the laver is brass? And I'm like, yeah, it represents judgment. Yeah, you know. And he said, and then by the Spirit revealing to me in Revelation, when John, in my mind, I was seeing John when he was describing Jesus, and he got down to the feet of brass. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, I want you to paint your feet. I want you to paint your feet brass before you go up and minister.
Oh my God.
I want you to take, the Lord told me this. He said, I want you to take your shoes off, and I want you to paint your feet brass. And I'm sitting there in praise and worship. I'm like, what? What? So I look at my brother. Said, come here. So I'm sitting down there. I said, man, I need you to go run to Home Depot and go get me some brass paint, right? And it's like, they only got like a song or two left, and we're going to start. I said, hurry up, because I got to. So he takes off. He comes back on the last song, right? And I see him, so I run out there in the parking lot, and I take off my shoes and my socks, and I sprayed all my feet brass, and, you know, and legs all brass, right, like that. And I put my shoes and socks back on. Yeah, it was wet. You know, I put my shoes and socks back up, and, you know, I went up there, and I started to preach and minister on the tabernacle of Moses. The tabernacle, the man, and the full armor of God. Man. You talk about a message.
It was powerful.
Talk about a message. And while I was, when I got to the man and I started describing, you know why the altar was brass and the laver was brass? Because it represents the gospel. Now, and I said, let me take you to a scripture. And I took him to the scripture and I read it to him. And when I read it to him, I took my shoes and socks off. That's where that picture come from.
Mm-hmm.
That's where that picture come from right there. That's where it, I did it at Resurrection Life and I did it one other place and they had took that picture. But the Lord revealed to me that day, I said, it's because Jesus' feet was burned as brass. And this is what it represents, a man. That proves beyond the shadow of a doubt that the altar and the laver represents repentance and baptism. Shod your shoes with it. I'm sitting down here today. I'm sitting right here and the Lord starts speaking to me. And he told me, he said, what does the shoes represent? And I'm like, they represent the gospel, Lord. And then all of a sudden, he brought me back to the beginning. The shoes, your shoes and mine that we wear represents the curse. The whole reason we wear shoes on our feet today is because of the curse. The Bible said, when Adam sinned, the ground was cursed and it produced thorns and thistle. Wow. When he was in the garden, he didn't wear no shoes. There was no curse. And I'm like, That makes perfect sense, because the gospel of peace, right? That is what's dealing with the curse. The brazen altar and laver. He dealt with the curse. When Adam was put out of the garden, God clothed him, right? But he had to put his own shoes on. He had to make shoes, because when he started walking, he felt the curse that was under his feet. And I'm like, then all of a sudden, he started connecting the dots. Watch this. Then the next thing I think about is, we always have this picture when, you know, to be in the presence of God. He says, watch this. Moses comes to the presence of God, right? He's wearing a curse. The curse is on his feet. It's a representation of the curse. And the Lord told Moses, take off your shoes. Because the ground you're standing on, there is no curse.
Right. 2 weeks ago, I said, Lord, please explain to me why to take the shoes off.
Man, then, and you know what? It all started 2 weeks ago. And then, I think about the next thing. I think about Joshua at the Jordan. Joshua crosses over the Jordan. He meets an angel with a sword drawn. Joshua, you know, says, you know, to the angel of the leader of the host of the army of the Lord. We know that's Jesus.
Amen.
The leader of the host of the army of the Lord. He said, are you for me? Are you for us or against us? And he says, I'm for neither. But as the leader of the host of the army of the Lord, take off your shoes, for the ground you're standing on is holy. He was standing in the presence of God.
Amen.
There was no thorns or thistles there, brother. And he took off his shoes and fell on his face and began to worship. And it was no angel, because you can't worship an angel.
Mm-mm.
And I'm like, then I realized that God starts putting things together. The shoes represent the curse. Right? That's why the priest, when they came into the holy place, you can see it right here. If you look close on this picture, there's not one priest in here that's wearing shoes in the holy place. They were commanded not to wear shoes, because where they was no curse. It was holy. And that's why Jesus told Peter, if you don't let me wash your feet, you'll have no part of my kingdom.
Wow.
If you don't let me wash the curse off of you, well, you'll have no part of my kingdom.
Yeah.
And he says, oh Lord, not only my feet, but my hands and my head too. He said, no, no. If your feet is clean, well, how do you clean your feet? Repent and be baptized, then your whole body is clean.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So we walk around every single day, and just in the aspect of people walking around every single day, shoes on their feet is a representation of what happened in the very beginning, the curse. God revealed that to me this morning. That's not the message. Y'all ready for the message now?
Yeah.
Hold on. All I did was just prepared you.
Yeah. Okay.
It's not, does not, it has nothing to do with, you know, people getting together. You know, when Jesus said it, he commanded them, and you need to wash others' feet. The only way that you can wash them is through the word.
Yeah.
It's the only way you can wash them. Because it's not about the physical dirt that's on your feet. Because the dirt that's on your feet will testify against you. Because the dirt is the curse. And that's why when Jesus sent the disciples out to preach the gospel, he said, if they don't receive the gospel, shake the curse off your foot and let it remain with them. Shake the thorns and the thistles and the curse. Shake it off in front of them.
Right.
If they won't receive me. And the curse stays with them. But you go. But those who do receive you goes into another.
Amen.
Amazing, huh?
Amen.
Wow. Kind of reminds me of some times that Boaz took the shoe off and held it up. Remember that? At the gate. Oh, you guys. Wait. Where was... Watch this now. Where did Boaz remove the shoe from? Outside the gate. Where is the altar and the laver? Outside the gate. There's a shoe. There's the shoes for you right there.
Mm-hmm.
A covenant was made with Boaz removing the shoe. A covenant. What is a covenant? Repentance and baptism. The shoes. Y'all with me?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Watch this. Now let's get started. If you haven't been here, what we've been doing and what God had told me to do and begin to show you guys is how the Feast of Passover and Yom Kippur is the same feast, one and the same, but God flipped them.
Amen.
Right? We've been through that. Tomorrow evening begins the Feast of Tabernacles, okay? And I done, you know, been through enough with you with all of that, connecting dots and stuff like that. First thing I'm going to do to you, I want to show you, is I'm going to throw some idioms at you. Some, like, you know, the day before yesterday, a couple of days ago, was Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the day that the priest would enter in behind the veil and, you know, put the blood on the mercy seat. There are some themes and idioms that they call this day, okay? And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to give you those themes, and then we're going to get into where we're going, because, you know, I'm going to show you beyond the shadow of a doubt where Adam fell, where the Eastern Gate is. You guys know this, but that's not where I'm going. But I'm going to paint a picture for you guys today. Now, ready? Yom Kippur. The name of the message today is called the Watergate. The Watergate. Yom Kippur. There's some names that in themes and idioms that they say about this date on Yom Kippur. Okay? Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement, the day when the priest would enter in behind the veil. That was in the fall of the year. Jesus fulfilled it at Passover. He died, rose again, entered, you know, through the veil in heaven, and put it the blood on the mercy seat in heaven. And that's, they're one and the same. There's some themes and idioms of it. Yom Kippur is called, it means the Day of Atonement. Right? That's just happening. Well, Passover is the Day of Atonement. It's the day, just like I said, Jesus put the blood, right? It's, now watch this now. Yom Kippur is called the Day of Face-to-Face.
Right.
The Day of Face-to-Face. Right? And, you know, that's why Jesus was born at this time. Why? Because we beheld His face. Right? Born from a woman, laid in the manger. First time we came face to face with God. That was in the fall of the year. It wasn't December 25th, I'm sorry. It was right now. Watch this. It's also called the day or that great day. What does that mean? The day or that great day? Well, the Bible talks about in the New Covenant, in the New Testament, it's the day that we shall see Him face to face when He returns. Right? We shall see Him face to face. Right? Which is absolutely amazing. And when Jesus had arose from the dead, they saw Him as God face to face. Right? They didn't recognize Him. That goes into a whole nother thing. It's also called that great fast. It's a fast day that they would fast. Now, it's pretty amazing that this Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, they fasted a couple of days ago because they don't know if God's going to receive the sacrifice they made. So they fast all that day. And the Bible's, you know, pretty clear that when Jesus came, you know, and got on that altar in the middle of the Jordan on the Day of Atonement, the same day that they're going face to face, the same day He's standing on that altar, you know, what happens next? He goes in the wilderness and fasts. I'm going to explain that to you. Amazing. New revelation on it, what it is. What I'm doing is showing you how they both connect to both the feast. Okay? And then he says, the last one is, it's the day of the great shofar. The day of the great shofar, Yom Kippur. Well, the day of the great shofar happened in the springtime when the children of Israel was at the mountain of the Lord, at Mount Sinai, and there came a sound of a great trump, the great shofar. So here is a direct connection. Atonement in the fall is being directly connected to Passover, being one and the same. It's not only called that great day, it's called the day of the awakening blast, right? The dead in Christ will rise first? Wow. And you might not catch it, but I have to lay this groundwork out for you so you're going to see it, what's coming. So, it's the day of the great shofar, the awakening blast. It says, this is the day, now check this out, this is the day that Adam, that God killed a lamb. He's standing outside the gate, God kills a lamb, and for the first time he sees what his sin actually done. And the idiom for it, it's called that great day, it's called the day of awakening. His eyes were opened, right? And now he's seeing the consequences of his sin and what they did outside the gate. Adam sees the realization for what he has done. This is where we get true repentance from, when we realize that our sin and what our sin has done to Christ on the cross, right outside the gate. The last thing that Yom Kippur is called, and think, man, this is, man, you guys, it's called Nila, the day of Nila. It's N-E-I-L-A-H, the day of Nila. It's called the day of the closing of the gates. The gates closed on Yom Kippur. All right. All right, Lord. Only you can reveal this, because you are amazing, Father. The past couple of weeks, the Lord's been dealing with me and showing me about, talking to me about the Watergate, okay? And I didn't fully understand it yet, but there was a lot of things the Lord had showed me about, you know, Joshua and the Jordan and 12 stones and the children of Israel coming in to the promised land and all that stuff. So, I'm just going to set it up for you. Here goes. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray right now, Lord, by your Spirit, Lord, that you'd reveal it to them, Lord. Open their eyes and ears, Father, and their heart to receive it, because it is absolutely amazing, Father. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, and amen. The first sacrifice that's ever made, is on the day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, okay? God sacrifices a lamb at the eastern gate of the garden, the east gate of the garden that was eastward in Eden, all right? On an altar at the Jordan River. Now, I'm just going to show you how I know that where the children of Israel crossed over, the Jordan River, is actually the eastern gate of the Garden of Gethsemane. It's really easy to figure out. Really easy. When, watch this. When Adam sinned, God put him out eastward from the garden. Right? Okay, it still won't connect the dot though. The next one we see that goes eastward from there is Cain. And Cain went eastward and dwelled in the land of Nod, where Babylon is built. Period. It's done. How do you know that? Because directly east from Jerusalem is Babylon. Therefore, he wasn't over there in Iraq. Because if he was in Iraq and went eastward from there, it would be over there in China, I guess, or someplace, you know, over there, right? But beyond the shadow of a doubt, to go eastward is to go away from God. Same thing, you know, it says that Adam, when he went eastward, God put him out of the east gate, right? It says he went about 15 miles upstream, and that's what's called the city of Adam. So he only went 15 miles. He didn't even get to the Sea of Galilee. So he's still in the same place, beyond the shadow of a doubt. So they're there where the garden is, but they're on the opposite side of the river, the Jordan River. We know that God told Abraham, I'm going to take you to a land that flows with milk and honey. He took him from Ur of the Chaldeans, Babylon, and brought him all the way to Jerusalem. God told Moses and the children of Israel, I'm going to bring you to a land that flows with milk and honey. He brought them to the Jordan River, and they crossed over into the land that was there. That was the land, right, where God, that when Joshua crossed over, God was on the other side. Same place Abraham, after coming back with the spoils, he met, you know, Melchizedek, you know, who was a king priest, right? Well, there was no kings and priests back then. He was the king priest of Salem, which is Jerusalem, who he gave a tithe to. Where's he at? Where's the king priest at? The Bible says that he was a picture of Jesus, right? This is the land that he's in. When Abraham came to the land, he says he made a sacrifice because he had, you know, God walked through the pieces. Remember that?
Yeah.
And he said, I didn't know, for God was here in this land. So Jerusalem is actually the garden that was eastward in Eden, beyond the shadow of a doubt. Now watch this. So I'm setting up the place where God put, you know, there was a garden that was eastward in Eden. So Eden is a place, there was a garden in it, and I'm showing you how that eastward in Eden was a garden, and that garden was right by the Jordan River, and that's where the gate, the east gate of the garden was. That's where Adam is put out of the garden. And that's why Joshua builds an altar there. This place is marked by God. Now watch this. God sacrifices a lamb at the east gate of the Garden of Eden on an altar at the Jordan River. Note this. The Feast of Tabernacles follows Yom Kippur. Now, and watch this. You're going to get this. This is amazing stuff right here. I'm about to drop on you. So Yom Kippur is the Day of Atonement. This is the day that God, now Adam, is removed from the garden, so he no longer has a house. Now, watch this. Yom Kippur, and then the Feast of Tabernacles. Tabernacles means dwelling. Yeah. Adam sinned. God takes him out of the house he was living in that God provided for him, right? Makes an atonement for him and clothes him in the Feast of Tabernacles. He's put clothes on him now, makes an atonement for him, makes the skin wraps for him. So now his body is clothed, makes a covering, passes over his sin, and sends him away. So what happens next after Yom Kippur? Well, he's got to go make a tabernacle to live in. That's why we get the Feast of Tabernacles. Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. Why Rosh Hashanah? Because Rosh Hashanah is called the chief or the head of the new year. Why? Because that's when Adam sinned and time began. So it began a new time. That would be the chief of the time or the head of now a new time, a new season, because now Adam is, he sinned. And now we have the fall. That's why it's called the fall. Now God has to make an atonement for him, right? Yom Kippur. And now he goes in the wilderness, and it's the Feast of Tabernacles, right? He's got to build a tabernacle. But hey, it gets better than that. Watch this. So Jesus comes to, on Yom Kippur. His ministry is beginning. Right? Jesus comes to the altar that Joshua had prepared for him in a Jordan. He's standing on that altar. He is the atonement. And then he goes in the wilderness, same place Adam went. Watch this, and fasted. Why? Because the first Adam, put out of the garden where the food is, on an altar, God builds an altar, makes an atonement. Adam now goes in the wilderness. His food supply is cut off. Yeah. He's got to be a tiller of the ground to work for his food. So now he goes into the wilderness. He's got to build a house for him and his wife. So now he's keeping the Feast of Tabernacles. And after about 40 days of fasting, when he's about to die, the angels show up, just like Jesus in the wilderness, and feeds him bread. The manna in the wilderness.
Amen.
Wow. Did you guys get that?
Mm-hmm.
Did you get that?
Yeah.
So what Jesus did at Passover, right? Now watch, Jesus at Passover, I got to stop. I don't want to get ahead of myself. This is my book. Watch this. So you understand that. Note, the Feast of Tabernacles follows Yom Kippur. Adam, when leaving the Garden of Eden, would now have to build him and his wife a tabernacle, a dwelling place, because he had lost his home. And this represents the children of Israel. Watch this. Watch this. The children of Israel, you got Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. God makes a sacrifice, right? They are leaving the Garden of Eden. They're going eastward. And, and then they got to go dwell in tabernacles. The children of Israel, atonement is Passover. The children of Israel, right? But let me just tell you this. The Garden of Eden, you have the Garden of Eden, the gate that's right there. Remember, Jesus was baptized in the garden, in the Jordan River, right? In a place called Bethel Berea, which means the threshold of the gate, or the door, or the doorway, right? So where Joshua built an altar, is where Jesus is baptized. He's standing in the gateway or the doorway where he's baptized. And then, like Jesus crucified outside the gate. I'm going to tie that all in. So now, there's a sacrifice and there's water on the Day of Atonement in the fall of the year. Now the children of Israel in Egypt, right? There's a sacrifice on Passover that is put on the doors, right? The door. The Jordan River, Bethel Beret, where Jesus is baptized, is called the door. In Egypt, they put the blood on the doorposts and the lintels, and they got to be ready to go, because now they're exiting Egypt. Where does God take them? To the water. He takes them eastward, just like Adam leaving the garden. These are mere images. One is happening in the fall. God changed the times and the seasons and showing you the exact replica of what's now happening on the Passover, the springtime. So the children of Israel, guess what? They have no more home on Passover. They make a sacrifice on Passover. They have to leave, right? So if Adam's leaving the garden, what's in front of Adam? The Jordan River. Well, guess what? God had to open the gate. God had to open the water gate so that Adam could walk across on dry land to the other side. And now the water gate closes. God's on one side and Adam is on the other. And there's no way they can come back. Because the word Jordan means descender, but it's made up of Jordan. And Yor and Dan is two words. It means the waters of Dan, judgment. If you try to cross over the waters of judgment and they haven't opened for you, then you will die. You will die. So, you need a pen?
No. Just real fast, when they left Egypt, make sure your sandals on your feet.
Yes.
It was the opposite because you was coming out.
Very good. He said, take your staff in your hand, gird yourself, and put your sandals on your feet, right? Because they was leaving. They was going into the wilderness of sin. The curse. They gone into the place where the curse is. So now they're leaving by the blood. So let me go back to Adam now. So go back to the children of Israel. They're in Egypt. They shed the blood, the atonement. They leave. They go to the water just as God opened the water gate for Adam. Now because they have the blood on them, God parts the Red Sea, opens the water gate, and they go through to the other side. Right? There's only one problem. This is Passover, just like atonement. So guess what? Now Pharaoh and his army is trying to come in behind them to take them out. But the problem is they don't have the blood. So the water gates close on them and judgment hits them.
Amen.
Wow. So now when the children of Israel get up on the other side, they ain't got no more food. Yeah. 2 million people, 1.5 million people just left Egypt at 12 o'clock midnight. The bread hasn't even risen yet. They out of water, they out of food, and they don't have a place to live. Oh, does that sound... I'm not telling you about Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and the Feast of Tabernacles. I am telling you about that, but I'm in a spring feast over here. You see? I'm showing you the spring feast in the fall, in the spring. So when they left the land, guess what they had to do when they left Egypt and came up on the other side after they did that little dance and the water gates closed? They realized they're going to be fasting for a little while now. It's a time of fast. Didn't Adam fast when he left?
Yeah. That's what I remember.
That's exactly right. They murmured and complained because they had no water. They came to the waters of Meribah, which means bitter. But they saw a tree, right? And cast that tree in the water, and it made him sweet. That's the word. He was just baptized in the sugar spring. He was baptized, the sweet waters. That's what he was just immersed in. Watch, you want to know crazy? I don't know none of this is happening. Meaning, the message that God is forming and showing me wasn't complete till yesterday. But it was a couple of days ago that the Lord spoke to me and told me that I had to baptize Nick on this day, a couple of days ago. And then I connected the dot because it was on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. It was on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, right?
Amen.
That Jesus stepped on an altar in the middle of the Jordan and he was baptized.
Amen.
Not to say, after I've done gave you now the beginning of the new year, Rosh Hashanah, Nisan, the beginning of the new year, Passover, the atonement, the unleavened bread, you know, the perfect sacrifice, the innocent lamb that God did, you know, for Adam's sin. I've showed you the Feast of Tabernacles and how they went. But when Jesus was on that altar, also the Holy Spirit came down on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, just like the Holy Spirit came down on Pentecost. These two feasts, beyond the shadow of a doubt, are one and the same. You can't even touch that. I mean, it is like, now watch this. So now, God tells me, you know, all of this is, he's doing all of this. Besides, 2 weeks ago, I get a call, we got to go to the Mississippi River, because where you pay the toll across the bridge, the gate, the tunnel was flooded underneath it. The water gate. God had me in a tunnel pumping water out, and it's all part of, I'm going to show you something, and you don't even know it. Where we go and what's happening, actually, it's all God ordained in his plan so that he can unfold what it is he wants to show me. Watch this. Show us. Man. So, now, I want to show you my poor Bible. Thank you, Lord. I want to show you something because I gave you names and idioms so you can connect the dots. Now watch this. Before Moses came, God made a sacrifice on an altar. God built the first altar. He erected it in a place that from then on, that's where you're going to sacrifice. How do you know that? I'm going to show you. I'm going to read it to you. Watch this. Now, Adam and Eve has put out the gate, the garden. And this is what it says. And Adam knew Eve, his wife. Remember the idioms I told you. What Yom Kippur means. So you are going to see, you're going to tell me, when I'm reading this, you're going to see clues to what day it is that this is happening. Watch this. Genesis chapter 4, verse 1. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, for I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. That's a twin. She didn't conceive again. These Adam and Abel is a picture of the first Adam and last Adam. This is what's being set up. Watch. It says, and again she bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, like Jesus, and Cain was a tiller of the ground, like the first Adam. Watch. And in the process of time, what is the process of time? I'm going to tell you. It came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground, and Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of the flock and the fat thereof. Your bells should be going off and ringing. What time? What day is this? Yom Kippur. How do we know? Cain is bringing fruit. Fruit is not ready until right now. I even went into the Hebrew Strong's Concordance to find out to make sure. The fall's already happened. They've been put out of the garden. And if Cain is bringing an offering to God in the process of time, means that God had signified a time when an offering had to be made to him. Yom Kippur. And in the process of that time, Cain brought the fruit, right? Therefore, we know beyond a shadow of a doubt, it's in the fall of the year. Therefore, this is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And watch this, and Abel brings a lamb. Why? God said to Cain, Cain, you know it's blood. He knew it. You got to put yourself there, because every year, Adam is going there making a sacrifice at the eastern gate of the Jordan River, where an altar was set up by God. That's where they learned it from, their dad. And now it come in the process of time, they're old enough, now they're bringing their sacrifice. Every year, Adam's bringing a lamb. But Cain, he brings something from the ground that's cursed. And he's going to offer something that's cursed to God. And God, listen what he tells him. It's going to give you, watch, it's going to give you another reference to what day it is. And Abel, he also brought of the firstling, verse 4, of the flock and the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but unto Cain's offering he did not have respect. And Cain was wroth, and his countenance fell. Wait a second. Wow. His countenance fell. Fall. Right? Well, who's got a what Bible you have? You got an NASB or what Bible? New King James? You got a New King James? Give me your Bible. I want to read this next part to you guys so you understand it in the New King James. Watch this, he says. In verse, it says, and in the process of time, Cain brought an offering of fruit from the ground to the Lord. Abel, he also brought of the firstling of the flock and the fat thereof. And the Lord respected Abel and his offering, and he did not respect Cain and his offering, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. So the Lord said to Cain, why are you angry? And why has your countenance has fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? Watch. And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and its desire is for you, but you need a rule over it. What is he referencing to? Cain, you know what you're supposed to do is right. Your daddy didn't do right, and sin was at his gate, right. His door. Wow. In fact, they're standing outside of the eastern gate, the garden that's eastward in Eden. Listen, watch this. Every year, God, when Adam was put out of the garden, when out of the east gate, right? The God parts the river. The water gate opens. I know that. You ain't got to tell me. I know it opened. Because he's the one that opens the gates. And I mean, you're going to see it in a little bit. It's going to blow you away. The gates open for Elijah and Elisha. The gates open for Joshua. The gates opened for Moses. The gates are going to open again. Watch. Every year. Let me. Where's my Bible? Watch this right here. Watch this. Let me read a little further before I explain it to you. No, let me tell you. So now, God walks Adam out of the garden, and the waters open. And he walks him to the other side, or he stops by the edge of the water. This is what I see. This is what the Spirit's, showing me. And Adam and Eve cross the Jordan in Bethabaray, beyond the shadow of a doubt. And then God builds an altar. Waters open. God builds an altar and makes the sacrifice. Clothes him and sends him on his way. And he comes back. Right? And the water gate closes. Well, at this time of year, the water's low, but God made an altar on the other side. That's why Jesus came beyond the Jordan to the other side where John was baptizing. So now, every year, God is established when a sacrifice has got to be made. So now, every year, Cain and Abel, they come on this side of the Jordan, and they meet with God face to face. But there's a water gate that's closed. Watch this. They make their sacrifice on the altar. And now God is having a face-to-face with him. Whether the offering is going to be accepted, but the water gates never open. Because the sacrifice that they're making of a lamb will never, an animal sacrifice, will never open the gate. It'll never open the gate and allow you back into the promised land, to the Garden of Eden. Won't happen. Every year, not only Adam and his sons and Enoch and all of them, even Noah knew when he came out of the ark, he planted a vineyard, and when the grapes were ripe, what did you say? He built an altar. Wow. Is that fruit?
Yep.
Is that fruits?
Yep.
Adam had passed down to all the generations where they had to go every year to make a sacrifice. It was commanded by God through the oral teachings of the forefathers that were passed down. And they knew it, and that's why Cain and Abel was bringing a sacrifice at the Jordan River. So now, God floods the earth. So now, things are changing, right? Watch, let me keep reading. Look at this. Let me keep reading right here. Look at this. This is awesome. So God says, and the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? So he's having a face-to-face with him. And why is thy countenance fallen? That's what happened to Adam when he ate of the fruit. His countenance had fallen. He lost the glow, the light. His countenance was fallen. He's seen what sin did, right? If thou doest well, and I read that to you, and it says, and Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field, watch this, that Cain rose up against Abel his brother and slew him. Cain was killed on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. Cain killed Abel. I'm sorry. Cain killed Abel on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. That's why Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the fall, it represents the law and a judgment of God. And that's why it says that the blood of Jesus speaks better things than Abel. Abel's blood cries vengeance. But God's blood, Jesus, cries grace. Same feast, exact same thing. Watch. Now to even, it says, and the Lord said unto Cain, this is the same day, because he's talking with him. Where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? Watch. And he said, watch this. God, watch this. And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. And now thou art cursed. Atonement was the curse, right? What they did. That's when the ground, right? Now, he tells Cain, now thou art cursed from the earth. Cursed from the earth. That's where the curse was at. Watch this. Which has opened up her mouth to receive thy brother's blood from thine hand. The earth opened up on Yom Kippur to receive Abel's blood. The only other time the earth opened up to receive blood is when Jesus died at Passover. The earth shook and the rocks rent, and the ground, the earth opened her mouth. You with me now?
Yeah.
Same. Watch this. When thou, watch this, when thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. Watch this. This is crazy amazing. He says, a fugitive and a vagabond shalt thou be on the earth. This is Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. The same time Adam sinned, and he had to leave. And Cain said unto the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, thou hast driven me out. What day is that? What day is called the day of driving them out? Yom Kippur. Yeah. God drove out Adam. Yom Kippur. Watch the next thing. Yom Kippur is the day of calling, being face to face, right? Watch what he says. Thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the earth. Who is that? That's Adam, his daddy. Adam was taken from the red ground. He formed his daddy out of the red ground. Now Cain is being driven from the face of the ground. That's his dad. Yes, it is. Watch. And from thy face. What's Yom Kippur called? The day of face to face. This is the day that Adam sinned and was had to be put out from the garden, driven out from the garden, from being face to face with God. Cain kills Abel on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and is driven out. He becomes a fugitive and a vagabond. He's got to go build himself a tabernacle. Wow. Connecting. The Bible says in the last days that he would pour out revelation and understanding. It's just like, what, man, look at this. Let me. We ain't got to the best part yet. Cain and Abel bring an offering to the same place in the process of time. Let's read Genesis 4. We did that. Question, what is the process of time? It was a day that was instituted by God for a sacrifice to be offered. A day of remembrance of the consequences of sin. What is the feast called? What are feasts and festivals? What are they called? Something that God said that we are to remember. Are you you serious? Watch. The day God made the first atonement for sin. It's a day of remembrance of the consequences of sin. The day that God made the first atonement for sin. It was Yom Kippur, the day that God made the first atonement. God instituted the time and the place where every year it would have to be done. The place where they would have to come and meet with God and bring their offering and meet with Him face to face at the east gate of the Jordan River in Bethabaray, at the threshold of the garden, of the threshold of the gate, of the threshold of where Adam was put out of the garden. Do you think it's by coincidence that Joshua builds the altar there? The place where they would have to come and meet with God and make an offering to Him face to face. O Cain, why has thy countenance fallen? That's a face to face encounter. In fact, Cain knew what God looked like. Cain knew. And the secret of understanding, you've driven me out from the face of the ground, who looks identical to your face. My punishment is more than I can bear. And that's why Cain and Abel were twins. One represented Adam that fell, that brought the curse, and the other represented the other Adam. That would be, hey, Cain's name means smith or metal spear. He was a tiller of the ground that pierced his brother's side. Christ hanging on the cross pierced his side with a metal spear, and blood and water flowed outside the gate. Where was Cain? Where did he kill Cain? Outside the gate. Hold on. I ain't told you nothing yet. God standing on one side of the river and fallen man on the other in the place that's called the house of the passageway.
You want to send your wife home while you do right now.
Thank you. Take notice to the offering that is being made by Cain and Abel, because Cain's offering gives a clue as to what time and year the offering is being made. Cain brings the fruit, and the fruit is not ready until the fall of the year, and Abel brings a lamb. Just by looking at Cain's offering, we could see that the day that they're making this offering is made on Yom Kippur. The process of time in which God required an offering to be made as an appointed time, a festival, a reminder, a remembrance, a feast, a moed that was commanded by God, required by God as a remembrance to the consequences of sin, but also as a future hope that one day the gates might open again. Son!
Ah!
Open the gates!
Lift up your hands.
Tell them. Get it out. Tell them.
No! It ain't time! Yes, it's time.
Tell them.
Woo! Son! Golly! You in for a ride! It goes deeper. But also as a future hope that one day we might be able to return to Eden. To be able to live with God again face to face. Now, every year, it was required for them to travel to the east gate of the garden that was eastward in Eden and meet with God face to face on the Day of Atonement.
Amen.
Cain and Abel on one side of the river and God on the other. What is separating them from God was a sacrifice in a river, an altar, and a laver.
Lord, what did you say? I said, get in the water.
But you have to die first. That's why God told me I had to baptize him on that day. The same day that he, God the Father, parted the waters. Is that crazy? In the waters that God showed me where to take him. We was running late. It was almost 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock ended the Day of Atonement. That evening, 6 o'clock. You know what time I baptized him? 5:57. I said, Nick, we got to get to the river. And I'm thinking, we're going through Pearl River. Nick's like, we can baptize here. I know. I see the spot. I know where we got to go. Then, when we got to the river, we was on the west side of the river. Right? We had to walk across the water. It was freezing. We went on the other side because the spot where God told me to baptize him was, you know, by the bridge. Underneath the bridge, there's a deep spot. So me, Jason, and Nick, we walked across the river, went on the other side. Me and Nick, it's freezing now. We get in the water. Are you ready? Are you ready? Jason, hurry up. We sitting there by the water. Jason comes down the thing over there. I said, what time is it? He's like, it's 5:53. I said, hurry up. Hurry up. So he takes off his shoes. He comes running across the water over there. All right, okay, we ready. Ready? So we got to do it on this day.
Amen.
Yeah. And come to find out, the waters that we baptized in is called the Sugar Creek. Sweet waters. Sweet waters. How can that be? Take me to a tunnel at the floodgates of the Mississippi River where the bridge crosses over. Watch. Now every year it's required for them to travel to the east gate of the Garden of Eden and meet with God face to face the Day of Atonement. Cain and Abel on one side, God on the other. What was separating them was a sacrifice in a river. Still today, what separates man from God is an altar and a laver. But if you receive the Lamb that God provided, the waters of separation will open for you.
Amen.
Watch this. Right there, the Lord says, the opening of the water gate. If you try to cross over and the water gate has not opened for you, well then the waters of judgment will crush you. Maybe now we could see why Moses was not allowed to cross over. It's because of what he represented, the law that separates us from God. Right? The same law that was orally given to Adam in the very beginning, and it was passed on to his sons. Animal sacrifices were required, but they could never cross you over. Only Yeshua, can do that. And only Yeshua, could do that. And the death of a sacrifice would have to be at the Jordan River in Bethabara. That's why Jesus had Joshua rebuild an altar at the Jordan Hold on, boy, because it's fixing to come. Now, when Joshua, watch this, what opens the water gate? What opens the water gate? Joshua is standing at the Jordan, whose name means Jesus, commands the priest who's carrying the tabernacle, the ark, which is the representation of Jesus Christ, the ark of testimony, enters into the river. He's the key that opens the gates. It's that ark that opens the gates of separation. What? Wait.
I got it, yeah.
So, now, if that's true, then Jesus, when he came to that altar, did he open the gates of separation? Mm-hmm. The priest with the Ark of the Covenant was commanded by God to go before them, and they were to follow behind, but not too close. As recorded in the book of Joshua, when the priest stepped into the Jordan carrying the ark of God's presence, the waters rolled back all the way to the city of Adam. The ark, made of acacia wood, which speaks of the incorruption of man, of Christ, and the wood, which speaks of humanity, is a picture of the ark of our salvation, Jesus Christ, who was made a man, who did not see corruption in the grave, right?
Right.
He was and is the ark of the new covenant, who came to the very same place where the water gate opened for Joshua. The place where God was on one side and fallen man was on the other. When Joshua crossed over, who did they see on the other side? God. Joshua, the leader of the host of the army of the Lord, when he crossed over, who did he come in contact with? God. Take off your shoes, for the ground you're standing on is holy. He then proceeds and to the Jordan, standing on the altar, and the water gates open. What? The water gates open when he was standing on the altar. You know that? Here, let me show you. Luke chapter 3, verse 21 and 22. Now when all the people were baptized, it came to pass that Jesus also being baptized and praying, the waters above the heaven, the firmament, was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended like a dove, in the shape of a dove, and rested upon him, and a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." The waters of separation, the firmament above, rolled back when he stood on the altar. The water gate above. Luke chapter 3, verse 21. Here, let me read another one to you. Check this out. Watch this. Revelations 21. Let me read this to you real quick. The Bible says that when the Lord returns, right, the heavens roll back like a scroll. The heavens are called the firmament. When God separated in the beginning the waters from the waters, right, and dry land appeared. That's what happened, right? Now, what separates us from God is the firmament, the waters above. But it's Christ when he stepped on the ark or the cross. When he returns, it rolled them back. No longer is there a separation between us and God. We can come boldly to the throne of grace, right? Through the waters, through the gate, into the presence of God. Revelations 21 says, in verse 21, and the 12 gates were 12 pearls. What? Did you ever want to know why the gates in the new holy city, Jerusalem, is made of a pearl? Where does a pearl come out of? The water! Comes out of the water. Comes out of an oyster. How? When that oyster opens, it gets something inside of it that does what?
Irritates.
The what?
Does that kind of sound when the gates open, what was happening kind of, you know, irritated Christ? He didn't want to have to do it. But a pearl was formed. Oh, wait. I think there's a parable that says something about him being the pearl of great price.
Yes.
He is the gate. He is the door.
Yes.
Woo. Ah!
Woo.
Not open sesame.
Amen.
Open says Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah.
Amen.
Bam!
Yes.
And dry land appeared.
Amen.
And don't try to follow me if you ain't come through the altar in the water.
Come on. You still got a gulf to go through.
Hold on a second. That's right. Woo! Woo! But he's holding the water. That's what I'm talking about. Brennan's got it. Revelations 21:27 says, 21 through 27, watch, this is amazing. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. That's Jesus. Every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was as pure gold, as transparent as glass. And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple in it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten, and the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which were saved shall walk in the light of it. The nations that were saved is going to be permitted to go into this garden. Watch this. God is bringing us back to the garden. Watch. And the gates of it shall not be shut. Golly! Yom Kippur is called the day the gates close. Passover is called the gates the day opened. The gates open for Moses, Passover. Open for Joshua, Passover. Oh my Lord. Hold on a second. The water gate. It just so happens when all of this is going on that God, we get a call to go by a man who is a Palestinian man to do some work for him.
Yeah.
I get to talking to him. He's from Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
What? This man tells me while he was in Lebanon in 1973, when they had the Six-Day War, he was shut out of Jerusalem and lost his home. June
man, his daddy's dying, and he told me how he came to the Jordan, and four times he had to try to get across that Jordan. The last time he did, but they lost their land. What is the coincidence? I'm talking to this man about the 12 stones in the Jordan. He tells me he knows where they at. He crossed the Jordan there to try to get into the promised land. On the fourth time, 10 of them, I think, or no, 10 or 12, 10 or 12 of them. No, 12. That's crazy. 12 men, 12 stones.
12 tribes.
They went in, snuck in, but they had to get out. Or the law would have got them and killed them. They said, we tried four times, but every time we go across, when we go across, the helicopter was passing and killing men as they came across. Because the gates are closed.
Yeah.
Watch this. And it says, in Revelation chapter 22, it says, and he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and the Lamb. And in the midst of the street thereof, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the trees were for the healing of the nations. We have access now to the trees, so we live forever. We got access through Jesus, who opened the gates for you and me. And there shall be no more curse. Verse 3. Man, he's talking about, and there's a river that flows out, and there's a tree on either side, and there shall be no more curse. Where's he taking you back to? Yes. Connecting the dots. He says, and there shall be no more curse, but the throne of the God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. In verse 4, and they shall see him face to face. I'm just about done here. The Watergate. One of the three gates of Jerusalem's east side. Now I'm gonna bring you home. The waters of separation. Kind of remember a parable. And there was a certain poor man who died, whose name was Lazarus. And there was a rich man who died as well. And Lazarus went into Abraham's bosom in Sheol, which is paradise, it says. Translate Sheol in the Greek, went into paradise, Abraham's bosom. And the rich man died, and he went into a place called hell. And this rich man says something to Father Abraham. Father Abraham, I am in torment in these flames, in the wilderness of sin. Can you send Lazarus to dip his fingers in the waters of the gulf of separation to come cool my tongue? And Abraham says, neither can I come to you or you come unto me, for there is a great gulf that's filled with water that separates you from me. And them waters are the waters of judgment. You have been judged. You had it good. But you rejected it. He says, well, Father Abraham, send Lazarus back to tell my brothers not to come here.
And he says, not even one raised from the dead would they believe. But they have Moses and the prophets. So, Moses and the prophets, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's the law. Can the law and grace, can the two, listen, can the two sticks be fused into one? Yes. The gate in Jerusalem where the law was read in Nehemiah 8 verse 1 and 2 was on Yom Kippur. And the gate that it was read at was called the Water Gate. The gate that entered into the city of David. Oh. What? Nehemiah was commanded to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And the only gate they didn't have to rebuild was the water gate. It was the only gate out of all the gates that was left standing. What? Oh. Watch this. This gate, the enemy is so deceiving. We look in the back of our Bibles and they say the real Mount Sinai is over there in the Sinai wilderness. But we know the real Mount Sinai was on the other side of the Gulf of Aqaba, the Red Sea. The enemy has done everything he possibly can to hide truth from you and me. That's why he was so protective of what was going on when at the Jordan River and what was happening. Satan, that's his gate. He was the eastern gatekeeper, the cherubim. Watch this. This is the gate. I went to Israel. They took me to a gate where they said that, you know, Christ was crucified outside the gate. If we're looking at Israel from the Mount of Olives, and we're looking at the Eastern Gate, there's the Eastern Gate, there's right on the north side is the Sheep Gate, the Eastern Gate. Watch this now. They don't give you the name of this gate. And then they give you the last gate way over here at the end, which is called the Fountain Gate. Well, this gate right here in the middle, which is the city of David, which is the Gihon spring, and a river flowed out of Eden, the Gihon. Well, that gate is called the Water Gate. That is the gate that David came in with the Ark of the Covenant every six paces making a sacrifice, because the city of David is the Water Gate. David brought the Ark in through the Water Gate making six paces, stopping and sacrificing, and he brought the tabernacle. He set up the tabernacle of David in the city of David where the Ark of the Covenant went into. That is the gate, that bloodstained trail that was laid out 1,000 years before Christ came, is the gate that Jesus came outside of, the Water Gate. He was crucified outside that gate. I'm sorry to tell you, but you know, you look at the Dome of the Rock and the Eastern Gate that's bricked up. I'm sorry, Muhammad, you bricked up the wrong gate. He bricked up the wrong gate.
is still there.
Yeah.
It's where they did all the baptisms. It's where Jesus came to, and you know, where the angel would come and stir the waters, and the first one that got in was healed. Well, he was the angel of the Lord that stirred the waters. He came there that day. And X is the man who's been sick, who's been lame for 38 years. You know, what's wrong? Well, every time the angel of the Lord comes and stirs the waters, I can't get in. Someone goes in before me. What do you think he was there for? What do you think he was there for? He come to stir the waters. Oh, hey.
Hallelujah.
Pick up your mat.
Yeah.
I ain't stirring no waters today. In fact, he would stir the pool, but I'm going to stir your waters. And you're going to be healed.
Amen.
Pick up your mat and go. This is the gate that Christ would be led through and then crucified on an altar that God prepared for him before the foundation of the world. Watch this. He hung on a tree. Y'all with me? Listen. This is the gate that Christ would be led through and then crucified on an altar that God prepared for him before the foundation of the world. He hung on a tree because the tree of the knowledge of good and evil represents death. So as the serpent hung from the tree, so as the serpent hung from the tree and brought death by deception, so Christ was hanged on the same tree and gave his life. I'm sorry, people. It wasn't a dogwood. He hung on a fig tree. He bore the curse. It was nailed to him. He was nailed to it. So Christ was hanged on a fig tree and gave us life. So if you look close, into the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, can you see Jesus? Can you see him? Can these two trees, the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, become one tree? Yes, they can. Old covenant, tree of the knowledge of good and evil. New covenant, the tree of life, has been fused into one tree. Isn't it funny that Jesus likens himself, just as Moses lifted up the brazen serpent in the wilderness and put him on a pole, a brazen serpent, so must the Son of Man be lifted up on the same pole. And all that look to him will be saved, will be healed.
Amen.
And the two trees have become one. Father, you
are crazy amazing. You, Father, only you are awesome. Words can't even describe how amazing you are. Father, we worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you, Father, that you've made a way through the water gate by the blood of your Son, Jesus. We claim that today. And Lord, you told me to take my shoes off because the ground that I would be standing on today, Father, was holy, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the people that was able to be here to receive it straight from you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Amen.